Welcome back to another usual upload. Let's talk about hooks. Unlike most board games, Scrabble was invented in 1931 by architect Butts. The premise being crosswords, but with turn-based combat. Like Mario Kart, it's a simple game. Given 7 letters at all times from a bag of letters, construct a word connecting to the existing words on the board to gain a score. For example, first, or ligands. It also has a banana-themed worse version. There are a lot of stories about the original inspirations for Scrabble other than crosswords, such as Edgar Allan Poe. One likely inspiration that stands out is the competitive word game Anagrams. Flip over letters and construct words out of them by combining them with the words that were constructed by everyone previously. The evolution from Anagrams to Scrabble, besides the Cartesian plane, is the fact that Scrabble takes into account letter frequency, both for its scoring and distribution of letters. Apparently, Butts came up with these frequencies by looking at newspapers. Probably saw a lot of these. And so that begs the question, is Scrabble a game of words, or is it a game of numbers? Butts believed there to be 3 types of games: number games, dice-slash-card games, which apparently don't have numbers, and word games. This was before Death Stranding. He hoped that Scrabble, like chess and backgammon to their own categories, would become the most popular game in the word category. And so Scrabble is indeed a word game. Similar to Anagrams, the strategy of Scrabble relies on the ability to take the state of the letters available and combine them into a permutation that exists in the dictionary. So perhaps a dictionary could play Scrabble. Computers began playing Scrabble as early as the early 1980s. Monty Plays Scrabble existed as a portable device for if you wanted to play Scrabble on the go, or as a program on microcomputers such as the Apple II for if you wanted to play Scrabble against Drew Gooden. Monty was said to provide a fair challenge, so long as it was allowed to take 3 minutes a turn and be wrong. The being wrong part comes from the Scrabble rule of being able to challenge the validity of another player's word. Monty's word generation came from a dictionary in its disk of originally 12,000 words, eventually 44,000, and then even more. But reading from the disk is a very slow process, as observable in Monty's play speed. And so, for challenging words played by human players, Monty actually used what programmer Robert Walls called linguistic analysis to guess if a word is valid, which occasionally led to Monty calling out some of the more obscure but still valid words, and therefore be penalized with a skipped turn. This problem could have been entirely circumvented, of course, if Monty could just read his dictionary quickly. And so, the race to make Scrabble on a computer soon became a race of memory compression. Another computer opponent from around the same time was the one for the computer edition of Scrabble. In order to face this reading problem, Peter Turcan of the University of Reading came up with an algorithm that seemed to go through all of its words in reverse order of length, until it found a play that it deemed to be possible and good. In 1982, it had 9,100 words on the Apple II, and in 1983, it had 12,000 words on the ZX Spectrum. Words were packed into as little bytes as possible, and on the ZX Spectrum, this was done together with Huffman coding, which encoded letters by their frequencies. The compression was so good, in fact, that it gave the computer an advantage by allowing it to cheat and make up its own words. Before either of those, though, between 1977 and 1979, Stuart C. Shapiro of the University of Buffalo, along with a team of colleagues, developed their own algorithm for Scrabble on a DEC System 10 with 1,500 words, and then a Cyber 173 with only up to around 2,000 words. But those words were stored on a tree. Note that tree here comes from the word retrieval, and Shapiro's tree is not so much like the plant as it is like a choose-your-own-adventure book. Each page has a single letter, as well as the choice between including that letter or excluding that letter. Making either choice brings you to another page with a similar setup, as well as all the words made up of the letters chosen thus far. Of course, pages and choices here are just Minecraft story mode terms for blocks of data that we call nodes, and pointers to other nodes in the computer memory. Following along the branches of the tree with the ability to backtrack allows us to quickly access words of the same or similar letters, which is quite useful for a game like Scrabble. But what's better than a tree? That's right, a dog. DOG stands for Directed Acyclical Word Graph. Unlike Shapiro's Minecraft tree, the DOG is based off of a prefix tree. The prefix tree is what most programmers know a tree to be. Instead of the descendants of each node being a yes or no, the descendants are all the possible letters that could come next in a word. This ensures that words are grouped together with other words of the same prefix, which is quite useful for a game like Scrabble. But the best thing about prefix trees is that they save space because every common prefix is using the same nodes. What a DOG does is it takes a prefix tree and does what a prefix tree does to prefixes to suffixes, merging words from both ends to save even more memory. In Scrabble, every word must be valid, even if it's made at the same time as another word. And so, to verify if a word on the board is truly valid without having to calculate it every single time, we can store which letters are possible on each position of the board for a horizontal or vertical move, which are two separate sets of letters. Combining this with the DOG gives us Appel and Jacobson's world's fastest Scrabble program, with a lexicon of 94,240 words, taking only 1 to 2 seconds to compute the entire legal set of moves on a VAX 11780. But what's better than a DOG? That's right, a GADAG. GADAG stands for Graph Acyclical Directed Directed Acyclical Graph. By the time it was the 90s, computers had enough memory for multiple DOGs. To read a DOG, you must always go from the start of the word to the end of the word. But that's not how Scrabble works. Any position of any word can hook onto any position of another word, so long as they share the same letter. A GADAG is like a DOG, but instead of storing a word once, it goes through each position of the word and stores all the letters going up to that position in reverse order, followed by a separator and then the remaining letters of the word in regular order. This allows us to quickly search from the letter that we are hooking off of in Scrabble. And as Stephen A. Gordon says, runs 2 times faster, although takes 5 times as much space. In a world of GADAGs, DOGs, and maybe even double DOGs, the matter of generating every possible move within one turn of Scrabble is a matter of 1 second. But given all those moves, which move should we choose to do? As Scrabble on the computer became more advanced, Scrabble on the human became more advanced as well. Once you surpass the skill level of a dictionary, Scrabble becomes quite different from anagrams. Obviously, when choosing a move, you want to score points, but you also want to score points in the turn after this, and the turn after that, and you don't want your opponent to score points. One special motivation for holding on to good, usable letters instead of playing them is the bingo, which awards you a bonus 50 points for playing all of your letters at once. And with a 50-point advantage, getting a bingo is almost always more strategic than not. One of the inventions to come out of the Manhattan Project was the Monte Carlo method, named after Stanisław Ulam's uncle's gambling problem. When trying to predict something unpredictable, why not just simulate randomly a bunch of times and choose the option with the best average? This is one of those ideas that got invented as soon as computers were invented. In the case of Scrabble, due to the nature of its strategy, these averages aren't just computed from the score, but rather also the values of the letters remaining in the rack, which can be defined by some sort of variation of their distributions and how well they combine together, or by just making a computer play Scrabble against itself a bunch of times. With this simple evaluation, you can then simulate the next 1 or 2 rounds, both for yourself and your opponent, after each potential move several times and be left with their average values. This estimation carries us until the endgame when there's no more random tiles to be drawn from the bag and we can conduct a more deterministic search. This algorithm, with some variation, improvements, and optimization, has been the basis for Scrabble programs since before the GADAG in the 1980s. There's Maven, which was bought and is used for Scrabble video games, and then there's also the newer open-sourced Quackle from around 2005, which is arguably better. And so, Scrabble becomes a game of statistics. But there is a flaw in the Monte Carlo method, which is that it's really lame. What is this, the scientific method? What are we, scientists? Like anything in science, the way we set up the algorithm is not free from bias. The Scrabble bots do not take into account the opponent's personal strategy. They'll just assume that the opponent will play optimally according to their own evaluation. They'll also only take into consideration the tiles on the racks and in the bag. The programs put barely any emphasis, if at all, on the tiles already placed on the board in the decision phase. As for that decision phase, simulating for every single possible move would take far too long, and so the moves actually simulated for are a candidate subset of moves that are statically evaluated to have the best potential. Mind you, none of these are bugs. These are all intentional decisions made by the engineers who made these algorithms, who are often Scrabble players themselves. And so, in some way, you can say that when a program is made in the image of a Scrabble player, it is actually made in the image of the specific Scrabble player that made the program. And that specific Scrabble player doesn't believe that the state of the board or the volatility of the opponent matters very much in Scrabble strategy. The fact that these computer players are biased ones as opposed to perfect ones becomes evident in play. Currently, Quackle is very, 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 very good. But it's not, as some people may say, superhuman. A human prodigy who is also the world's best Scrabble player, Nigel Richards, has famously won both the French and Spanish World Scrabble Championships without knowing either language. And he plays significantly and consistently better than Quackle. A non-Nigel Richards top-tier grandmaster such as Kenji Matsumoto might find themselves in a bit more of a difficult position against Quackle, but will still only lose a bit more than half the time. Unfortunately, the field of Scrabble bots hasn't seen a whole lot of development in the last decade. Maybe they should make one that can exploit the working class. Of course, in a world of AlphaGo and DeepNash, a truly superhuman Scrabble bot doesn't seem to be too far off, built off of neural networks and Nash equilibria. So what would that mean for Scrabble? Well, the meta in Scrabble strategy between humans and computers have constantly improved off of each other ever since the Monty days. The challenge in programming, shifting from a memory problem to a simulation problem, to perhaps soon a game theory problem. Maven didn't even consider having nine-letter words until Joe Edley played Methadone, while today Quackle's algorithm gets continually analyzed and constructively critiqued by online Scrabblers such as Kenji Matsumoto, Cesar Del Solar, and Francis Desjardins. With assistance from Quackle, Woogles, and Macondo as tools, Scrabble could be easily analyzed as a game beyond word generation, growing quickly from a meta of primarily memorization to one of long-term plays, offense and defense, resource management, bluffing, and gambling, through decades of iteration. Throughout this evolution, Scrabble bots remain designed by Scrabble players and for Scrabble players, their features and biases reflective of the community, and does not seek to replace nor cheapen the experience of Scrabble itself. Not that that would really make sense in the context of a board game anyway. Maybe it's because the developers of Scrabble bots, like the majority of the Scrabble community, understand the real goal of Scrabble, which is the human sense of having fun. When David Boies lost 482 to 465 to Quackle in the 2006 Scrabble Open in Toronto, he said, "It's still better to be a human than to be a computer." And in the incredibly rare, perhaps only interview with Nigel Richards ever done at the Iskandar Malaysia World Festival of Scrabble in 2010, Richards' advice for beginners' improvement in Scrabble was to learn the words, but the most important thing is to enjoy yourself. But what do we do while we wait for Alpha Scrabble? Well, we might as well take another look at those biases. As everyone knows, the way to make something unbiased is to take something biased and do the opposite of all those biases. And so, we should make a Scrabble bot that only looks at the tiles on the board, assumes that the opponent is crazy, and always considers every single possibility. And once after we've solved bias, we can see how effective it was by taking a look at every single result of many, many games, six at a time.
dis plus rien ne me touche. Ce que je veux, c'est qu'on m'oublie. Je suis comme je suis et cela me suffit. Si j'accueille de changer, tu verras mes idées. On va faire le son, la splendeur de terre du thé.